Tonight on This Week, a live interview with the Prime Minister. Her first major interview on television since the election. Prime Minister, the summit in Washington ended not very long ago. There's no communique yet, but both leaders have given a press conference, a joint press conference. It's reported, and the news is coming in still, of course, that President Reagan has talked of it as a clear success, a summit lighting up the sky. Mr. Gorbachev has said that on the whole, the visit has justified our hopes. It appears, though, that there has been no breakthrough on an agreement to reduce strategic missiles by 50%, and no other major move. Is that, given the hopes that were there at the beginning, is that something of a disappointment to you?
No, I don't think it's a disappointment at all. I think the summit was bound to be a success. First, they did achieve the treaty, and because they were having a summit, and because one had been forecast for a long time, it made them that much more anxious to overcome the technical difficulties so they could get a treaty. That itself was a success. And then I always thought that Mr. and Mrs. Gorbachev would be absolutely tremendous in Washington. It's quite different, you know, to see a personality and to feel the warmth and to feel the animation of discussion and debate. And of course, that has been a success. And thirdly, you always create something of an atmosphere for the future in the discussions you have. You can't put your finger on precisely what goes forward, but you know the person better, and you've talked about things, and you'll find that after that, there's a possibility that things will go forward faster.
Are you still hopeful? It, again, hasn't been mentioned so far, that they will have that promised summit, that hoped-for summit in Moscow before the end of President Reagan's term of office?
Quite hopeful. I think they will get the agreement on strategic missiles. Again, it's quite a lot of technicalities because there are quite a number of different ways in which you can take the reductions. And of course, it comes very difficult verifying the results if the Soviet Union keeps some mobile missiles. But I believe that they will get it. I think it's within our grasp.
Do you believe that as a result of this summit, we really are at the beginning of a new era in East-West relations? Is it as important and as dramatic, the process that's now taking place, in your view?
I think the new era really began when Mr. Gorbachev made his famous speech. I think it was just at the beginning of this year, making it quite clear that the regime in the Soviet Union wasn't producing the standard of living, the standard of technology, the standard of social services, all the hopes that people had had for it over many years. And then that it had got to change, and then set out the kind of changes: more individual initiative, more personal responsibility, more personal involvement. This is very different from the central planning and control. So that was one thing. Can I just say the other thing? Is that he is the sort of person who had both the vision to see this and the courage and boldness to do something about it. And the other thing, he is a quite different kind of Soviet leader from any other I've met. He discusses ranges widely over any subject. Normally they read out from a rather sterile brief. Not so Mr. Gorbachev. So yes, that did offer the hope of a new age.
You sound as if you really do trust that man.
I never accept anything on trust. I'm always, if we have an agreement, trying to build in monitoring and verification. But I do know from having talked with him that he can get down, as indeed I can, to the real bare bones of an argument, really get to grips with them. And everything that he promised me on certain human rights cases that he would look at, and he would do his best to get families reunited, he has in fact carried through. And I have the very strong impression that if he says something, that he will do it. And that is the first and very important steps to trust and confidence. If you're negotiating on arms, yes, it's verification that matters. But trust is building up.
If there is a 50% deal, am I right that you have not been asked at all to make any offer from Britain on the Trident case?
It was made quite clear by both the President and by Mr. Gorbachev that the British and French independent nuclear deterrents were not in these negotiations.
Is there any stage down the road when you are prepared to put Trident on the table for negotiation?
We have never excluded it completely, but certainly, even at a reduction of 50% in strategic missiles, Trident is still such a small proportion of what the Soviet Union would have left that there'd be no need to negotiate on ours. There's a second and even more important point than that, which I put to Mr. Gorbachev very recently. Our independent deterrent is really an irreducible minimum. We have only 4 nuclear submarines. You must always have 2 on station to be certain, because otherwise you've also got 1 being maintained and sometimes the missiles being maintained. You can't really go any lower.
Would you be prepared to cut the warheads, submarines. Though? Would you be prepared to cut
now,
the warheads?
Now, it is possible in the future that if strategic missiles get very, very much further reduced, then we might bring some of the warheads into negotiations. I do not see that stage coming yet for a very long time.
Do you look forward to, or do you fear the day when the world leaders who possess nuclear weapons would sit down and together sign a treaty abolishing, eliminating the very last ones on Earth?
How could you possibly know that you had eliminated the last ones on Earth? How could you possibly know that some nations which have been trying very hard to produce nuclear weapons didn't actually get the breakthrough? Technically, it is known how, in theory, to do it. You cannot be sure. And because you can't be sure, then you do still need a minimum nuclear deterrent yourself. You can't disinvent the knowledge. You can't disinvent the information. I am not so much interested in a nuclear-free world. I don't think it's attainable. But I am interested in a war-free world, particularly a war-free Europe, where the last 2 world wars have started. To keep a war-free Europe, you need, I believe, to keep a nuclear deterrent.
In Europe, as a result of the INF deal, the Pershings and the crews are now going to go. You've said that in the meantime, until there's agreement on conventional weapons and on chemical warfare, we have to maintain and modernise the nuclear weapons that are left. Can you, given that that's the case, can you say whether you would encourage or not the decision or the idea of bringing cruise missiles on aeroplanes, launchable from bombers, into Europe to compensate for the departure of Cruise and Pershing?
Let me put it this way. That treaty is absolute on intermediate land-based nuclear missiles. It must be honoured by both sides. Both sides will honour it. Both sides have other nuclear weapons. Both sides will modernise their other nuclear weapons. If you're responsible for the defence of a country, that defence must be such as to deter, and it must be effective. Therefore, you must continue to modernise weapons so they continue to be effective. Both sides will do that.
Does that mean that you don't rule out air-launched cruise missiles in Europe, which is the one issue which the Russians say would undermine the treaty, although formally the treaty permits it?
I have not, in fact, ever heard the Russians say that it would undermine the treaty. What I do know is that the Russians are working very hard on cruise missiles of all kinds. At the moment, we have in our air-launched intermediate weapons the free-falling nuclear bomb. Yes, there comes a time when that will have to be modernized because your aircraft may not get through. So, yes, you do have to consider that weapon. The Russians will be doing it. They will expect us to do the same thing.
Can I just say on that, that in fact, Mr. Gerasimov last week on this program said that, and I'm quoting him exactly, that to bring in air-launched cruise missiles to Europe would undermine the treaty, ruin the whole treaty, were his words. Now, you're saying, nonetheless, I'm going to reserve the right to do that.
But I'm sorry, he is not correct. The Intermediate Nuclear Weapons Treaty is about land-based nuclear intermediate weapons. That is what both sides have agreed shall be eliminated. Both sides have other air-launched nuclear weapons.
Wouldn't it undermine the spirit of the treaty, though, Prime Minister?
I am concerned to keep our safeguard, to keep our defences sure. I expect the Soviet Union will honour that agreement to the letter. So shall we. I expect them to modernize their other weapons unless we get further agreements. But as you know, I think the further agreements that are needed are on conventional and on the elimination of chemical. My task as Prime Minister is to keep Britain's and NATO's defenses sure and secure, and I shall.
Prime Minister, can we move on to the state of the world economy? Today it's been reported that the United States has the biggest trade deficit it's ever had. The stock markets have not yet recovered. Do you fear now that we are likely to get into a world recession?
I think that the rate of growth might slow a little. That, I think, is very different from a deep recession. I think the psychological effect of the drop is bound to be that some people will spend a little less than they otherwise would, because there's a new degree of uncertainty. On the other hand, one has to point out that interest rates have fallen, and that will to compensate to some extent for the fall in the stock market. The interest rates are reflationary. The fall in the stock market is deflationary, but I hope the one will compensate for the other. But I would nevertheless expect a little slowing of the growth rate, particularly when, as you have here, we have over 4%. There would, I think, be a little slowing of it.
Does that mean that the consequence here at home, if there is such a slowing, will be the end of the fall in the jobless total?
I would hope not. That would depend how much it did slow and what was the mix of manufacturing and services and so on. We're doing very well with reducing unemployment at the moment, and a lot depends upon how far we can keep up the rate of growth. But we can still reduce unemployment at a little bit less than a 4% rate of growth. But to some extent, it will depend upon the mix of jobs that there are available.
Would you like to see the Americans do more to cut their deficit?
Oh, yes. I would. But right now, we're waiting for what Congress is going to do to honour the agreement between the President and Congress. You know, for quite a long time now, some politicians have said to me, look, America was reducing her unemployment by having a big deficit and spending more than living beyond her means. Why can't you? And I said, but of course we can't. America is the biggest country in the world, and the dollar often is the currency which people will put their money into. But there will come a time when not even the great United States can go on living beyond its means. And they looked at me in astonishment. And one knew that time would come. And we never did it in this country. Well, not in my time. And it has caught up with them. And that's what one of the reasons, one of the main reasons, why we've come to such difficulties.
But your message to the President is, please cut more.
My message to the President and Congress is, first, honour the cuts and the decisions you have taken. Honour them as effectively as you can by taxation and by real cuts and not creative accounting. And then consider very carefully whether you can go any further.
The effect, of course, of all this on popular capitalism has been very considerable already. Should a responsible government not have made it much clearer before the sale of BP, for instance, that to invest in the stock market is a risk, it's a gamble, it's a roller coaster, it's not a safe form of investment? Shouldn't all those advertisements sponsored by the government have carried some kind of health warning?
That would have been very patronizing, wouldn't it? People are much more intelligent than you think. They know the stock market goes up and down. Of course they do.
What about the 270,000 who bought at the offer price, which is way above the market price?
Yes, indeed, but they know the stock market goes up and down too. The astonishing thing, according to some of the commentators during the fall in the stock market, has been how steady the small investor has been. The small investor buys, not really to sell the next day, the next week, the next month, the next year. Most of them buy, to put it as we would say, in the bottom drawer, to give an investment for the future. And yes, it will. They know that it may come down. They believe it will get back up again in time. So do I.
Doesn't the slogan...
They believe that the companies in which they have bought are sound. Their profits are good, their record is good, and they've got good growth potential. And there's a lot more common sense in our people than you give them credit for.
You don't think that the slogan now sounds rather tattered, popular capitalism?
Not at all. Not at all. The stock market is about down to where it was something like 15 months ago. No, that slogan is not tattered. We shall go on expanding and extending capitalism and popular capitalism. And it will give many, many people an extra income when they retire and something to hand on to their children. Look at the results that are coming now. You want me to stop?
The results
are good. I'm not going to.
It is always interesting to hear you going on, Prime Minister, but I want to move on actually to the next subject,
if we can, to
the health service.
But you don't want me to go on and on. I understand.
That's extremely good of you. You have, on occasions, repeated the statistics showing that real spending in the National Health Service has risen since you've been in office. Let us take that as read. At the same time...
And accepted.
At the same time, the eminent presidents of no less than three colleges of medicine have written to you in an unprecedented fashion, saying that the health services in the hospital, that the hospital services are close to breaking point. Do you accept their judgment on that?
I do not accept that the health service in the hospitals is close to breaking point. Let me give you some of the numbers of patients treated, because that's what we're talking about.
Are they exaggerating then?
Let me give you the numbers of patients treated. They have gone up considerably. Inpatients in hospital, 6.5 million a year, gone up from 5.5 million. Patients who go to outpatients clinic on attendances, 38 million attendances. Operations, the number of operations, enormous, 2,360,000, in addition to some of the acute services. These are not the figures.
Prime Minister.
Of a health, no, please, you're challenging me, and you must give me a chance to answer. These are the actual figures. There are more operations in heart bypass, more in cataracts, more in hip operations. These are extra patients being treated. You cannot say the health service is breaking down. Of course they want more money. There are more medical advances, and everyone wants them when they come.
Prime Minister,
and each year,
Prime Minister,
they get more money.
Prime Minister, those figures, again, are not in themselves in dispute, but what the doctors hearing this all over the land in hospitals will be saying is, yes, but our wards are half empty. Our incubators can't be used. There are reports of children, babies who have died because incubators weren't available to them. Cancer patients having routine operations, having them postponed, even though at the same time there were emergencies. The Royal Gynecologist, Mr. Pinker, if I can just quote him, one of these eminent figures that I referred to, saying this very day, the high-ups clearly don't realise what's happening. They need a good, except he said it rather more strongly than that, they need a good kick up the backside. That's what he said, Prime Minister.
It is not governments that pay for the health service. It is people, out of tax, out of value-added tax, out of income tax. When I came into Downing Street, they were paying on average, the average family was paying £11 every week to keep the health service going. After 8.5 years of Thatcher government, they're paying nearly £30 every week, the average family, to keep the health service going. The people who have been saying they want more, and each year they've had more, and this year the hospital service has had between £700 and £800 million more, they are now saying that another £200 million would do it. But we've already arranged that next year the budget will be an extra £800 million for the hospital service, an extra £1,100 altogether for the health service. And that's much, much more than what they say is necessary. 10 years ago, there was an inquiry into the financing of the health service done by Alec Medicine. When this amount of spending on it was way, way, way below what it is now, when the number of doctors was less, when the number of nurses was less. And Alec Medicine, who was then Vice Chancellor of Bristol University, he's a scientist himself, a very distinguished one, said two things. There is no way, and this was 10 years ago, which the National Health Service can fulfil all the expectations placed upon us. That was because medical science is moving so fast, and he said something else. We had no difficulty in believing the witnesses who said the National Health Service could take the entire national income. Now, of course it can't. People have to live within a budget. But, Mr. Dimbleby, the health service has been and will continue to expand. It has been and will continue to treat more patients. More babies are surviving. Now, I looked at the figures before I came. I gave them to the House this afternoon. 3,000 more babies survive every year now than about 8 or 9 years ago because medical science has moved on. Of course
that
they
does not
want
stop
more.
No, this is, Prime Minister, that is certainly true, but I think what these eminent
gentlemen that I've referred to and the heart surgeons from 9 different areas of this country dealing with children, and those who've complained to you from the intensive care units of our major hospitals would say is, yes, that is certainly true, but we are turning away baby patients now, and we're turning them away because the facilities that we have ready to use, we can't use because we haven't got the staff to staff them.
Well,
that's
now,
what they would say to you.
Now, one moment. There are far more paediatric doctors, paediatricians, than there were.
But are they lying then when they say this, Prime Minister? That's what I want to get at. What do you make of what they're saying?
Could I get a word in Edgeworth?
Of course you can, Prime Minister.
No, of course they aren't. If you were a doctor or nurse working in the health service, of course you would want more. My point is, yes, they have had more. Yes, they are doing more. Yes, they will continue to do more. There are more paediatricians. There are more paediatric nurses. There are more, particularly in intensive care. It takes quite a long to train them, quite a long time to train. Extra money has been made available and is continuing to be made available. But just remember what they said 10 years ago. We had no difficulty in believing the National Health Service could take up the whole of the national income. Of course it can't. I find people in hospitals very much more satisfied. They are saying to me in the House this afternoon, we need 200 more million. And what was my reply? But next year, you have seen the budget. We have arranged that the taxpayer will pay, because that's the person who pays.
Prime Minister, the taxpayers...
1,100 more million.
All the polls suggest, Prime Minister, that the taxpayers would be delighted to pay rather more for a health service and for hospitals that provided a better service, including all the improvements that you've made. Why don't you give them the chance to do that by saying, we'll defer tax cuts? We'll let you put it under the National Health Service.
Because when you ask them a question much more intimately connected with their future and how much they want left in their own pockets of their own money to spend in their own way, you get a very, very different answer. And I will not forget that the Wednesday before the election on the Thursday, when I was doing a phone-in programme, a nurse telephoned me. She said that her net take-home pay, I think she was a very young nurse, was £80 a week. And I said, she didn't say, she said, my pay is £80 a week. I said, but you're quoting your net take-home pay, aren't you? She said, yes. I said, you're telling me you're already paying too much tax, aren't you? She said, yes. I said, yes, but I'm on your side, because I think people at your level of income are paying too much. And I said, where do you come from? She said, mould. I said, I know mould. You've got a big new National Health Service hospital there, haven't you? So there we had what I get wherever I go. Even where we have big new hospitals created by the taxpayer on a capital budget that's gone up 42% since I've been in, even where we have nurses pay very much up, even where we have more of them, of course people still want more. The health service is an expanding service.
And you still believe it is safe in your hands?
My goodness me. Look at the extra patients that have been treated, the extra operations, the extra money.
As you were saying before,
I accept that. It required a Conservative government to create that wealth, to give that extra service. And it is safe. I think it is safe only in our hands.
I want to move very briefly on to a final area and ask you, what prompted the government a few days ago to intervene in the making of a BBC programme through the courts to stop it? It was about the role of the secret services. Why did you do that?
You constantly try to ask about security and intelligence services.
First question I've ever asked you about it, Prime Minister.
The media constantly try to ask. You know full well that it is one of the things that by their very nature they have to remain secret, and that there have been times in the House of Commons when understanding the nature of the services, and I was in opposition, I went into the House of Commons to support Merlin Rees in his decisions as Home Secretary on the security services, because he could not, I knew, get the full support of some of his own backbenchers who were left-wing. It is tricky. Of course, it's tricky in an open democracy that people want to know more, and yet you have to have security and intelligence services. And that is why successive governments, knowing their importance, do not discuss them.
Is it your intention, using the confidentiality rule as it applies to the contracts of civil servants, that no civil servants, past or present, should talk about any aspect of the security services, and indeed in other departments, about any aspect of their work in public, to take part in debate on such matters, to give information about wrongdoings that they may have uncovered in their view, that there should be a gag through that? Is that your
gag
plan?
I know that it is vital, the security of our country, and so we may be able to resolve many crimes, that people who work in those services should be capable of keeping their own information and not talking. In other words, they have a duty of confidentiality, not merely to governments, but to the security of the country and to the security of the system of democracy. They understand that, most of them, and so do ordinary people.
There is lots more I would like to be able to talk to you about. I may not. Prime Minister, thank you very much.
My pleasure.
That's all from this week for tonight. We'll be back in the new year. Until then, good night.